first week we lit the promise candle. This candle reminds us of the promises of God to send a Savior. That Savior has come and he has brought some gifts with him. The second week, we lit the forgiveness candle. This candle reminds us that we should forgive others as God has forgiven us. Only then can we truly experience the hope, peace, and joy as it is promised in the Bible.
Last Sunday, we lit the hope candle. This candle reminds us of the living hope that we have in and through Jesus. This hope is founded in the fact that God will do all that he has promised and that he will finish all he has started. Last night, we lit the Christmas candle. This candle reminds us to slow down, to put the busyness of the season on pause as we take a moment to reflect on the real meaning of Christmas. Today, we light the Christ candle.
So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger. For the past several weeks, we have been focusing on the gifts that Jesus brought as he entered into our world. Some of those gifts include the gift of adoption, which makes us children of the King, the gift of forgiveness, which is the foundation of hope, peace, and joy, the gift of presence, which is the foundation, which gives us lasting confidence and hope no matter what where we are going. Today, we focus on God's greatest gift of all, himself. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift.
Came to see Mary. She was doing laundry, and then the angel just appeared and she was really scared. So Gabriel was like, Mary, you're gonna have, what? I can't say it good. Mary, you're gonna have a baby. You're gonna have a baby and you will call him Jesus. And then Mary was like, I'm not gonna have a baby yet. I'm only a teenager, I'm not married. Then the angel Gabriel told Joseph that Mary is not lying. You are having a new baby. And so they met up. They went to Bethlehem, which was Joseph's old town.
They ride a donkey.
I don't know.
A camel.
Oh yeah, a camel.
She said, this donkey's fast.
They tried to go to a hotel and
they asked the keeper for a place to stay. The keeper said,
we have no rooms. Literally, no rooms.
So Mary and Joseph walked away sadly, but then he said,
the only place in here in Bethlehem that you can stay is a stable. And then he just pointed the way and they followed. When the shepherds were taking care of the sheep,
then they saw angels.
The angels said, a new baby is getting born, who is King of the Jews.
The angel were singing,
glorious. And then the shepherds said, I think we should go there and meet him. The second, I think, said, yeah, I agree with you. And the other said, yeah, me too. They had to walk through a bunch of grass and bushes, maybe have to camp out a night. And then the wise men heard about it.
And then a star appeared.
We should probably follow that star. It's pointing down to the barn.
So maybe we should follow it. Maybe. So the wise men went to Jesus.
They gave them gifts.
A stuffed animal, like a hippo one, they have at home.
some diapers, and some wipes, and some milk, some shoes, some Jordans.
Gold, Frank, and Latimer.
And I don't know how I would survive in that barn. Too stinky, too crowded, and ugh.
I think he probably pooped because the room was very smelly. Thank you for coming.
He's adorable.
He's gonna be our best friend.
I love you, and you're the best baby I ever seen. There, I said it.
The new baby is gonna change the world.
So all that we do this season, we do because we see the Savior who is Christ the Lord. So this morning, it's with joy in our hearts that we acknowledge that He has come. He has lived, He's died, and He's risen again as the Savior for me and everyone else. And so we worship You with all we are. Take these gifts given to you, and in your name we pray.
Amen. Thank you, Gussies. You know, in my family and my household, it's kind of a tradition on Christmas morning that before we get to opening the gifts, we normally sit down and either myself or one of my kids at this point turns to Luke chapter 2 and we read through the Christmas story just to keep that reminder fresh in front of us. And as I sit here this morning, I'm thinking, I like this so much better. I love that this is Christmas Day and that we get to come into this place and we get to fellowship with one another, that we get to sing with one another, and that we get to just take this time and to remember. I know we say that word a lot, but we've got to keep reminding ourselves. Otherwise, we get swept away in all the busyness and chaos of what's going on around us. So thank you for being here. I'm really enjoying this morning with you. I'm going to invite you to get your Bibles out and turn to the book of Matthew chapter 2 with me this morning. And as you turn to Matthew chapter 2, just a brief reminder of where we've been and what we're going to do today. And if you have not been with us for the past several weeks, we've been talking kind of about the gifts of Christmas, so to speak. And the Lord really just kind of developed this for me as I went. And it's been very, very difficult trying to preach on the best gifts. I mean, because they're all so fantastic. I mean, really, as you think about all that we have in and through Christ, it really is an amazing, amazing gift that He has given us. And as we talk about Advent candles, right? We spent that very first week and we lit what we called the promise candle. And we had turned all the way back to Isaiah, don't go there, but we had started in Isaiah and we looked 700 years before Jesus came. God used the prophet Isaiah to announce to the entire world that He was going to send a Savior, to send a deliverer. And as we looked through that story, we went to John, which is not normally where you go for the Christmas story, but we turned to the book of John, and he summarizes the entire Christmas story in four words: the Word became flesh. And as we continued through that passage, we saw that one of those gifts that he brought with him is the gift of adoption, the right, the privilege, the authority to be called the children of God, the sons and daughters of God, and all that goes with that. I mean, we can spend an entire month and just talk about the adoption and the gifts that come through adoption, and we wouldn't have enough time still to adequately cover it. But how amazing, through God's promise and that adoption and those gifts that we have. And the second week, we looked at the gift of forgiveness. Because this time of year, as we talk about peace and hope and joy and all those things, Christmas, all those things that tend to elude us, or all those things that we look for in different areas other than in our relationship with Christ, season in, season out, right? We go through Christmas and we just never really get it, at least some of us. But we said, if you want to experience that peace, that hope, and that joy, it all hinges on forgiveness. Faith, have you accepted that gift of Jesus Christ coming and all that He did? Have you accepted that forgiveness? And then we said, that is a gift that is so powerful that you can't just simply receive it and keep it to yourself. Forgiveness is a gift that must be offered to those around us. And it might be that coworker, or it might be something more personal, much more difficult. Maybe it's a family member. Maybe it's a parent. Maybe it's a sibling. Maybe it's your child. But if you really want to experience that peace and that hope and that joy at a Christmas season, you better understand that gift of forgiveness. And we said, when you get that, when you really understand, then we have a joy, right? Then we have a joy that the world didn't give. And so we have a joy that the world cannot take away, and a joy that nobody else can take away, regardless of what it is that they have done to us. What a powerful gift, that gift of forgiveness. And then last week, we talked about the gift of His presence. And we looked at two aspects, and not presents like the presents that you find under the Christmas tree, just His being here. And the first reality that we looked at is His presence. One, it shows us that God is a God of His Word. He can keep His promises. If 700 years before, He can use the prophet Isaiah to say, a virgin will conceive and will give birth. And that happens. Boy, you can trust all the other things that He has said and all those gifts that come through that faith in that person of Jesus Christ. And then the other thing that we looked at was the fact that because He was here, His presence, He has experienced what you've experienced. He's experienced what I have experienced. He has lived through the difficulties that you lived with, right? We said tempted in all ways that we have been tempted, yet without sin. And so we wanted you to understand that this goes beyond the temptation the way you know it. This is so much more than you know, because He took on all the pressures. Right, and I shared a story from my days in school where somebody tried to be sympathetic with me, and if they haven't experienced what we've experienced, there's no way a person can be sympathetic to what you're going through. And Christ says, I can. And through that gift of His presence, we see how that builds such a profound hope in our lives. And today, we take a moment to recognize the greatest gift of all. Right? As you try to figure out these different gifts that God has given, and we've got many, 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 many gifts. But the greatest of all, and I don't know how else to summarize this other than God's greatest gift is Himself. Because everything else that we all talk about all hinges in God deciding, I'm going to leave my throne, I'm going to leave the comforts of heaven and all the glory and all the splendor of where He was. And He says, I'm going to go down in the midst of all of the betrayers. I'm going to go down into the midst of all those who are all about themselves and they become so selfish and they don't even think of me. I'm going to go down and as a gift, I'm going to give myself. And in Christ, in this gift that we have of Jesus coming in the manger, we have the presence of God. And see, before this time, all they had was the prophets. All they had was God's word, God's word, God says. And then God said, okay, that's not enough. I'm going to show up. And I'm going to do all that is necessary. And we think about that gift. And I want to ask you for just a moment. Has anybody in this room ever been a part of a gift exchange? Yeah, we've all been there, right? How many of you ever been involved in a gift exchange that turned out very badly for you? Right? You put a lot of time, a lot of effort into the gift that you brought to the party. And you look at what you got in return. You think, what on earth? I got gypped. Right? I think of a time when I was in Bible school. I was the college career director, and it was Christmas time, and we were going to have a gift exchange. And somewhere in the midst of all this, I'm not sure exactly how it happened, but apparently, are you all familiar with white elephant gift exchange? Where you're supposed to bring a garbage gift, and that's expected you're going to get something that's pretty much useless? Well, this really wasn't supposed to be a white elephant gift. This is not what the teens just went through. This was a gift exchange. And so my wife and I, we take our gifts and we go. And of course, everybody who goes, you get your gift and then you can steal and you can do all these different things. There's different ways to play. But as I got my gift, I opened my gift. And as I opened my gift, you'll never believe what I got. An empty roll of toilet paper. That's it. That cardboard too. You know what I'm saying? Somewhere, somebody thought, white elephant, we're supposed to bring a useless gift. And I'm thinking in that moment. And now, when you play that game, or at least when we played it, we got to pick, well, you can steal somebody else's if theirs is better. Nobody stole mine. I got stuck with the empty roll of toilet paper. That cardboard. Now, if you're a crafty person, maybe that's a good gift for you. I don't know. But for me, that was useless. At least put the toilet paper back on. No, don't put it back on. Just give me a new roll, okay? That'd be even better. But you know that feeling, right? When you put a lot of time and effort into something so special, then what you get in return, you kind of feel like, oh, man, that's it? That's all I get? Now, I want you to hold on to that story for just a moment, and I want to turn to Matthew chapter 2. And we're going to cover again a little bit more of the Christmas story this morning, and then we're going to make the point. And then we're going to give you a time of application, and then we're going to go home, and we're going to celebrate the rest of this day with our families. But as we come to Matthew chapter 2, we're going to start in verse 1. And after Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the time of King Herod, magi, or wise men, from the east came to Jerusalem. And I want you to stop right there for just a moment, because now as we're entering into this Christmas story, this is after Jesus was born. And I want you to remember, this is a little while after Jesus was born, okay? This is not the baby in the manger. But after Jesus was born, wise men from the east saw this star. And it was a little bit different than you saw in the video this morning. But they saw the star and they decided, we've got to follow this thing. They understood there was something supernatural, something significant about this star. And as this story unfolds, you're going to find out there's two groups of people in this story. You can write it down. There's the fools and there's the wise men. But this is all taking place after Jesus is born in Bethlehem in Judea. Herod the Great was king. And as these wise men were traveling, we come to verse 2. They come into this area. And they asked of King Herod, where is the one who has been born king of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him. And so these wise men followed a star. And there's a lot of different ideas as to what happened at this point in the story. Did the star disappear after they got to this area where they had to go to the king and ask what's going on? And I'm not going to go into all of those details. I've got some thoughts and opinions, same as you do. But I want you to see that as they go and they find the king and his wise men, verses 3 through 8. And I'm not going to read all the 3 through 8 for you. In fact, I'm just going to summarize it. And if you like to summarize, that's a spot you just kind of put a bracket in your Bible, verses 3 to 8, and you can label that area the fools. Because as the wise men come here, they come to King Herod and say, where's the king that's been born? And in this moment, Herod is very disturbed, as you see in the verses that follow. Why is he disturbed? He's disturbed because he is threatened. He's thinking, oh, wait a minute, I'm the king. I'm not going to share my authority with anybody. And in that moment, he calls all of his wise people together and all the seers and all the astrologers. He calls all the people that he has at his disposal. And he says, what on earth are these guys talking about? And they said, yeah, there's some prophecy about some king, some Messiah that's going to be born in Bethlehem. And yeah, that must be what they're talking about. And so they informed the wise men, well, this is what we know, but we're not sure where he is. And the wise men just got to be thinking, are you kidding me? The most significant event in all of history, and you guys are oblivious. You guys are blind. You guys are indifferent. And that's where you get the Chuck Schneider translation, they are fools. This gift that they have at their disposal, and they don't even recognize what's going on. In fact, they're so disturbed, King Herod says, I tell you what, go find them, and when you find out where they are, you come back to me. And he says in a very pious but very empty, shallow way, I want to worship him too. And we know from history, we know from the Bible, that he had ulterior motives. And so these fools don't recognize the gift that they have been given. But we come to verse 9. And if you want to do this, maybe you don't mark in your Bibles, I do, but 9 through 12, you can kind of bracket that and say, here's the wise men. Here's what the smart person does. This is what we ought to all do. Verse 9, and after they had heard the king, they went on their way. And the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. And so somehow or another, after they're done talking with the king, these wise men see the star once again. And the star continues to guide them to exactly where they needed to be. In verse 10 it says, and when they saw the star, they were overjoyed. And then verse 11 says, and on coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary. And this is how we know this is some time after. This journey that the wise men were on was a long journey. They had traveled quite some distance, and it had taken quite some time over terrain very different than the way you and I know it. They didn't have the expressways, potholes not included, right? It didn't matter. They had to go, and it took a long time. By the time they get here, there's no longer a baby in a manger. It's a child in a house. And so here's a dedicated group of men coming to find out, what is this gift? What is it that God has given to us? And they come to the house, and in this moment, they come face to face with the God of the universe. A child, mind you. And upon seeing this child in this house and his mother Mary, it says, and they bowed down and they worshiped him. Notice they put the emphasis in the right area just so there could be no confusion. They didn't worship Mary, they worshiped him. Who's the him? They worshiped Jesus. Why did they worship Jesus? Because they recognized in that moment that they have been found in the presence of God Almighty. Charles Wesley got it absolutely right when he wrote his song, Veiled in Flesh, the Godhead See. Hail the incarnate deity. Here these men look into this child's face and they see God. And in this moment, they are driven to response. Right? I mean, as you recognize this gift, this is what we spent all this time talking about. When you see the gift, you've got to do something, especially if it's a great gift. It demands a response of some sort. And here's these men, these wise men, right? We want to learn from the wise, not the fools, although we can learn from the examples of the fools. We don't want to mimic the fools. But here the wise men, it says, in the latter half of verse 11, then they opened their treasures and they presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And so we see these wise men driven to response, because in this moment they come to Jesus, they see God, and they know this demands a response. We can't just say, okay, that's good, that's great, and be on our way and forget it. They bow in worship and they present to him all these gifts that they brought, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And I won't go into the significance of all those with you this morning, but this is the point that we've been trying to make for the past several weeks as we talk about the different gifts right? And I've shared with you, it's been so difficult for me to put these messages together and really convey all the gifts that we have in and through Christ when he came to this earth. But this is the idea, is because of what he has done and what he has accomplished, we are provoked to response of some sort or another. Right? I mean, whether you recognize it or not, you're responding to that gift in some manner. You're either responding as the fools did, who were indifferent and couldn't give a rip or were threatened. Or you can respond as the wise and recognize that this gift is a gift from God. And as these men recognized, that gift was God. And they recognized all that that meant. Although they couldn't fully comprehend all that it meant, they recognized this was a very, very significant deal. And it motivated them. It drove them to a response. And in this moment, really, what can be said? How do you adequately repay? I mean, can you imagine, how do you adequately repay the best gift you ever received? You realize you really can't do that. You really can't repay that kind of a gift. And Paul struggles with this. And I'm going to share a couple other verses with you from the book of Romans. You don't have to turn there. But Paul struggled with this. What do we do? Romans 8, verse 31, it says, "What then shall we say in response to these things?" And the context of that verse is these things, and Paul goes on for quite some time about the security and the gifts and all the things that we have in and through that person of Jesus Christ. And as he's trying to evaluate all that we have through this baby that came, he's saying, what can we do? What shall we say? How do we respond to all of these things? And to go on to further encourage them, he says later on in that verse, he says, if God is for us, who can be against us? That's the latter half of verse 31. So in other words, he's recognizing as he's writing all these things to this group of people about what God has done and the gifts that we've received, he's going to recognize that some people are still struggling. And some people are still concerned about their security. Some people are still concerned about God's goodness. Some people are still concerned about God's ability to fulfill all the promises that he has made. But he's trying to get them to understand and recognize, if God is for us, who can be against us? And in other words, all these things that he has promised, he will do. And essentially what he's saying is this, if God is for us, who can be against us? You're concerned that these gifts might be taken away, the security might be taken away. If God gave them, something or somebody mightier than God is necessary to take them back. You understand that? Nothing can take away the gifts that we have in and through Christ once they've been given to us. And he's saying, if God has given, who's capable of taking that away from you? Nobody. But as we've been trying to point out for the past several weeks, you can give it away if you're not careful or if you don't fully understand. And it goes on in that verse 32, in that passage, it says, he who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, along with who, along with Christ, graciously, your translation might say, freely give us all things. Right? I mean, you understand? God has purchased the most expensive gift he could ever purchase for you, in that he gave his only begotten son, that he would come and that he would die for your sins. And that story starts as the baby in the manger. And God said, he's given you everything. He's given us the most valuable, important thing that he could ever give. What makes you think he won't keep on giving the other things he said he'd give you? What things? All the things. Right? What makes us think that as children of God, through that gift of adoption, that before we were the children of God, he's somehow given us this amazing, significant gift? How, as children of God, can we not think he won't continue to give us all the other things that we deserve? Why would he do less for us after we're saved than he did for us before we were saved? See what Paul's trying to get you to understand? He's done so much. Why wouldn't he keep on doing it? And so he's trying to get you to understand, too, that God's greatest gift was himself. And listen, when you give somebody yourself, when you give somebody all of you, there's nothing else greater than that. But when they do that, you get all the benefits of that person coming along with you. Amazing. And Paul, in another spot, and I want you to see this verse as well, 2 Corinthians 1:20. It says, for no matter how many promises God has made, and I tell you, if you spend time reading his word, you will find he has made a lot of promises. For no matter how many promises God has made, they are yes in Christ. It goes on to say, and so through him the amen is spoken by us to the glory of God. And in this, it's talking about how many promises. It's talking about all the promises that come in and through salvation. I made just a short list I'll share with you. The promises of blessing, the promises of peace, the promises of joy, the promises of goodness, of fellowship, of forgiveness, of strength, of hope, of eternal life in Christ. It's all yes. It's yours. You can have it. All of it. All the promises. It's yes, but it's yes in Christ. It's through this gift where God gave himself. All these other things, it all falls. So what's the greatest gift? It's God himself. He came and he says, with me, I'm giving you all of me, and I'm giving you every aspect of all of who I am. I'm giving you of my entire being. All made possible because of that Christmas morning when Christ came. And how do you respond? I don't know how you respond. I spent a lot of time dwelling on this. I tell you, you don't want to be lost in awe and wonder. Start reading through these Christmas stories, not just as a story. I try to encourage you to do this often. You read through the story and you put yourselves in the shoes of the characters. As you read those words, just let them soak in. Just reflect. Sometimes we just need to shut up and block out everything that's going on around us and just dwell on what these words are saying and the realities that are in this story. In our spot, I mean, it generates, it provokes us to do something. And I love 2 Corinthians 9:15. What else can you do? Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. Right? We've been trying for weeks to describe God's gift to us, and it's indescribable. And it's going to take a lot longer. In fact, that's what we do all the time. We're trying to get you to understand the gifts that are in and through Christ. And it's not just at Christmas time. As I've been dwelling through this or walking through this, I'm thankful in my prayers that God gives me many more Christmases with you guys, because there's so much more here. Oh, there's so much more in these stories that we've got to share and that you need to know. What is that indescribable gift? It is his son. It is the most wonderful gift that has ever been given. And it is the gift that inspires all other gifts. How do we respond? You see, I want you to think that as we talk about this, God has given that indescribable gift. He's given all of everything. Now I want to go back to just a moment to that story that I opened with. In that moment of that gift exchange, when somebody's put a lot of effort, specifically if you've put a lot of effort into something and you exchange those gifts, in that moment you get something back that's just so depressing. And as we've been talking for a long time, I want you to think this morning about what are you going to give back to God? Or more specifically, I want you to think about what have you given God? He has given us the most indescribable, amazing gift that could ever be given. What have you given in return? I hope it's not an empty toilet paper roll. I mean, you look at all that God has given to us. How can we respond in such a flippant, uncaring way? And so the gift exchange. Jesus says, listen. You give me your sins. You give me your guilt. You give me your shame. And I'm going to give you eternal life. Not really fair, is it? But this is why we talk about how great this gift is. This is where you got to understand you can never really fully repay, which is why we say that as we attempt to give back, all he asks is, you know, show some appreciation. Live according to the ways that I've shared with you, the way as I've encouraged you. Would you tell somebody about me once in a while? Would you respond in some way to this indescribable gift that I have given you? And what's amazing through all of this is God just sits back. At that amazing gift, he just sits back and he waits to see what you do with his gift. Because reality is what you do with his gift is what you do with him. And if you accept that, you accept him. And when you accept that, you appreciate all that he has given. And when you appreciate something, it drives you to response. It drives you and motivates you to do what he's asked you to do. And he said through all of this, whatever it is that you want, I am ready to give it to you. And that's the gift that God keeps on offering. You know, and sometimes we reject that gift. And when somebody rejects a gift from us, we finally say, okay, then forget it. But God is continually there with that gift. He's continually waiting for you to decide, what are you going to do with this thing? How are you going to respond? Because in it all, he gives us a choice. Because that's what love does. He doesn't say, I demand it, I force it. He says, here's what I've done for you. Will you accept it? And as we accept it, my challenge has been for the past month, what are you going to do and respond? This morning, we've got an opportunity for a gift exchange. And right here in front of the tree is this reminder, the gift that has been given. And on your way in, you have been given some ornaments. And there are some markers or some pens or something that are around there. And the idea this morning is I want you to get your ornament out. And I want you to write down what it is that you're going to offer back to God in light of all that he has given you. And then in a few moments, I'm going to read something first, but in a few moments, as you are writing down that gift, and hopefully my encouragement to you for the past several weeks has been, think about this, because I didn't want it to be a knee-jerk reaction when you came here this morning. I hope that you've truly given us some thought, and you're going to have an opportunity in just a few moments. They'll play, and you can come up, and you can offer this gift back to God. To say thank you for all that you... Now, I know there's some of you out there, you might be terrified because you're not altar-type people. Don't worry about it. Right? This is an invitation for all of you to come to say thank you, God, for what you've done for me. And in light of I'm going to give this back to you. And you've received multiple ornaments. And so maybe there's one or two things that you want to give and you want to put it on there. And that is okay. Maybe as a family, you want to give something as a family gift. Your family ever do that? Family gifts? As a family, you're going to hang a different one up there. Now, you can keep this completely anonymous if you want to. Or you can put your name on there, your family name on there, because for those who do that and want prayer, you've got my commitment that I'll pray for you. But secondly, there's a follow-up thing coming down the road if you'd care to put your name on it, and I will follow up a little later on down the road with you. And as you're thinking about what that is that you want to give back to God, and as I've shared for many, many weeks now, it could be something positive, it can be that negative thing, maybe you want to give up that fear, that worry, say, God, I'm going to give this back to you because you want this. And I want the joy and the peace and the hope and the things that you promised me. And so whatever it is, maybe it's a positive thing, I don't know, more time, more verses committed to memory, whatever it is. And as you think about that, I want to read for you these words from a song that is so powerful, at least in my mind and in my life. On the night that we did the Sounds of Christmas, John Nolf, young man who was here in our church, sat at the piano and he played and sang a powerful song for us. And I want to remind you of the words that are in that song as you think about what it is that you're going to give back to God this morning. The title of the song was How Many Kings. And this fits with our message and it fits with what we're trying to do. And this is just so powerful. It says, follow the star to a place unexpected. Would you believe after all we've projected, a child in a manger? Lowly and small, weakest of all, unlikeliest hero wrapped in his mother's shawl, just a child. Is this who we waited for? Because, why? How many kings stepped down from their thrones? How many lords have abandoned their homes? How many greats have become the least for me? And how many gods have poured out their hearts to romance a world that is torn apart? How many fathers gave up their sons for me? Those are some powerful words. How many kings? How many gods? Only one. Only one. And the song goes on to say, bringing our gifts for the newborn Savior, all that we have, whether costly or meek. Why? Because we believe. We believe. And then the song is a question, do you believe? Do you believe? And it goes on to say, all this for you. All this for me. So this morning as you're filling out your cards, those ornaments, those gifts that you want to give back to God. And I love this. And hopefully this is before you had the chance to get lost in all the other busyness and all the other excitement of this Christmas day. And as the piano plays for the next few minutes, I invite you to come up and offer that gift and just set it on the tree. And that's open for you right now.
folks are bringing their gifts up. Let's sing that together.
Would you pray with me? Father in heaven, as we gather this morning, our gift to you is represented by what's hanging on this tree. And Father, we recognize they may be meager gifts, but Father, it's from our hearts. And it's out of a heart of gratitude, and we say thank you for all that you have done. And as we make these commitments to give back to you, Father, I pray that this is something that we would keep front and center in our lives, not only today on Christmas morning, but Father, throughout the year, as we recognize all that you have done for us. So Father, thank you for your indescribable gift. We thank you that you found it necessary and a privilege to enter time and space so that we might have a relationship with you, so that we might experience peace and joy and hope and love and all these other things that we so desire. And we thank you that every promise, every gift in Christ is yes. Thank you for that this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Sing this closing song with us.
No birthday celebration is complete without happy birthday, right?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jesus. Happy birthday to you.
Stand as we close and go tell it on the mountain.
Great week.